Okay, good morning, everyone. Welcome to the panel that we're having today here at Columbia on diversity in the energy sector, which is a really exciting topic for me, and I'm glad that we have a crowd here. We have a great distinguished panel of experts. The way we're going to run this is to have a keynote speech initially, and then we're going to open it up to Q&A. Let me just say that the Columbia Center on Global Energy Policy is being webcast live, and both the full video and podcast will be available in the next couple of days on the website and iTunes. So stay tuned for that. And for those of you who are watching online, and I hope there are lots of you out there watching, as well as people here just in the room, you can ask a question of the panelists with the hashtag CGEPEvents and on Twitter at Columbia Energy. We're going to structure the Q&A because it is a intimate group in a very comfortable and open way. But please, if you do have questions, if you can just identify what your area of study is or your affiliation, if you're not from the Columbia community, that would be great. We are going to start today with Hosnia Hashim, who is really impressive. I was reading her bio on the way over, and really a trailblazer in the field in the Middle East region. Right now, she is deputy CEO of the Petrochemical Industries Company in Kuwait. And I was really impressed that she was the first ever woman appointed as a director of an oil and gas asset company that's producing 700,000 barrels of oil per day in Kuwait. And that's no easy feat, just in terms of the operational intensity of a role like that. So she's now the deputy CEO of PIC in Kuwait. And she's also the chairperson and executive director of the board of Equate Petrochemical Company, which has operations in Kuwait, North America, and in Europe. She has a lot of affiliations, so she's, I know, busy, which I don't know how she has time to come to New York, but she is on the board of TKOC, which is the Kuwait Olefins Company. And she's also had executive roles in the national and international segments of the upstream sector, oil and gas sector in Kuwait. She was vice president of operations for the Kuwait Foreign Petroleum Exploration Company and deputy COO of the North Kuwait asset of the Kuwaiti Oil Company. So she's been in the field for a very long time. And most important for this panel, she's been the founder and chair of the Professional Women of Kuwait in the petrochemical and petroleum industry, which is a really amazing initiative. And I know she's going to be discussing that as well. She's got a Bachelor of Science degree in chemical engineering, like most of the people are in the sector, which I definitely want to talk about a little bit in the panel, which is the what kind of academic background you need in order to break into this sector and whether that's still a necessity for the sector or not. And she's also a board member of the Hope Foundation, which is a humanitarian initiative focusing on global networks and outreach. So please join me in welcoming Hosnia to the podium. Thank you.
Dear panelists, distinguished guests, my dear student faculty, very warm good morning to you all. Before I start, I would like to thank Dr. Jason Bourdouf for inviting me in this session, Women in Energy program, to talk about diversity and inclusion. I will focus about in this my presentation on diversity and inclusion, the journey of Kuwait oil industry. So my presentation, I will. I will talk today about. I will talk about first on introduction, then brief about oil and gas industry highlights, young company profile and young professional, gender parity global and in the Middle East. Then I will take you about Kuwait journey and final reflection. The framework that anchor what I will tell you today is the energy sources and consumption forecast up to 2023. Most importantly, the key message of this plot published by BP on 2016 is that the industry of oil and gas is envisioning to be an important component of the source of energy beyond 2035. And the energy demand of the world will keep increasing. But you know this, right? As student and faculty of such organization, especially in energy, these are properly known forecasts. And that is the perfect introduction to my next slide. The plot is, in this slide, shows the high volatility of the oil price, an element that has marked our industry through the history. We can see boom and bust during our so many years, and this is now it come became a part of our business we need to deal with. We are currently imagining in a high uncertainty moment from where even our oil price was in 2014, nearly 120. Today is the average is 50. So different scenarios imply very different level of activities in tradition and untradition oil fields. And we must act with a caution, as this uncertainty is not good for recruitment action or plans or managing our workforce. So we need to seek our own country's forecast, help us plan for our own workforce management. Let's see Kuwait oil production and our plan. In Kuwait, we have a very ambitious plan. Today, our production is 3 million. Our target is to reach 4 million by 2020 and sustain that until 2040. So this is a challenging target. With so many activities we have today in the upstream part of our business, we need technology because we have to develop very unconventional oil, such as heavy oil, and to produce gas, which is new for Kuwait. We started in 2006, discovering a huge quantity and reserve of gas, and the production of that kind of gas is high temperature, high pressure. It needs technology. We need to use tertiary recovery and all the kind of enhanced oil recovery to produce that 4 million. So as a workforce, we need workforce. We have an international arm of our business in Kuwait, which we have nearly 60 projects around the world, in Canada, in Australia, in Norway, Egypt, more than 15 countries. So that's the upstream part. Even in the downstream part, we are increasing our refinery capacity and even petrochemical capacity inside Kuwait and outside Kuwait. So we are always seeking to enhance our portfolio. So nearly we have a 100 billion project is ongoing in Kuwait today. So as CapEx, we still, as a country, because 95% of our income is from the oil industry in Kuwait. So the government's putting a huge capital investment for future growth. That's really our strategy in Kuwait. So we are looking now in the expected change in employment. From 2015 until 2020, the percentage as presented by the World Economic Forum the energy industry will keep employing professionals, which will have to maintain their skill to match the technology challenges ahead of us in the oil and gas industry. So as the energy will keep employing, we are concerning about our own profile and evolution as in Kuwait energy. In this plot, we follow the evolution of the democratic profile of the Kuwait Oil Company, revealing that as we keep recruiting, because that obligation of the national oil company, we need to recruit Kuwaitis. We have today very advanced young company profile. So you can see from this profile that the age is from 25 to 30. So we have a young company. Our leadership then, we need to stay alert to the new style of the approach of the leadership to increment attraction and retention of the young professional. What do the young professional want today? We need to concentrate on this age of people which we have in the company. So a smiley, beautiful face from the young engineer we have in Kuwait. They expect that we as a leader to provide them rapid progression that want to lead immediately, enrich their career profile, better and more soft skill, more focus on networking, technical knowledge and enrich their technical knowledge, core values of the corporation, like unless we share with them how much we care about environment, nobody will come to that our sector. So we have challenges to handle the new generation really efficiently. And what about the challenges related to diversity and inclusion? Let's see firstly the distribution of the global scale of gender gap parity index. The color of this map are darker on the country for the country that have reached gender diversity. It's not surprising that the Middle East and most of Africa are in the lowest rank. But somehow, a good news that we are in Kuwait in the top ranked 10 country. We are the second, really, in the Middle East and Africa. So which belong, as Kuwait, we are part of the GCC, the Gulf Community Party. So we are proud that we in Kuwait, we are the second among all these people. So let us see the leadership and how much female we have today in the GCC country, the Gulf country, as a board, given the global distribution in the GCC, we have representative women in board and executive level nearly less than 1%. Why we have this situation? Let's see some of the challenges that still prevail the women in the GCC. The main challenges in the Middle East for the progression of the women in the oil and gas industry are, first, the culture. I think the culture is still, we are male-dominated area. Few women we have in the top management, hence few role model. Monetizing career path. If we stay in one career, we'll stay forever, 30 years, 35 years, so we don't have a career, clear career path. Work condition for women in operation is not ideal. HR policies not equal for women and men. Legislation, yes, some of our law preclude women to work in shift or in night in the field. So that's an obstacle. These are challenges show in the current distribution of the female. If we see the female in our sector, we have 9 subsidiaries in our oil petroleum sector in Kuwait. The percentage of women is changed from 8% to nearly 50%. The 50% is the head office. That's why we see more women in Kuwait in the head office. It's not in the field. We face challenge elevating the total percentage of women in our company, really. First, to establish a homogeneous situation across all the companies. The second challenge is to boost their participation as women in our industry in the role of in the field. So let's start with analyzing how we are recruiting a fresh graduate. In the next slide, I will share you the recruitment percentage. The recruitment of female has incremental as percentage from 11% to 23%, which is a good sign. It's an excellent sign. Structurally, this kind of recruitment does not entail or enable gender balance because a lot of activities, a lot of work in our company needs a worker, which diploma holders. In diploma holders, we all is women as men, as operator, well service man, welders. No women goes to that kind of career. So that's why the percentage is low. A lot of female is engineers. So we need as Kuwait to concentrate on those diploma holder and train our females in as to be how to be an operator. Those are challenge, and we are in a journey to uplift our situation and our solution, adapting our reality, legislation change. And we are trying to change that some of the legislation to allow women to work as shift worker and in very harsh environment. Our solution start start with the launching the Professional Women Network in Kuwait Petroleum Corporation and its subsidiary. We started that in 2009 as pioneer initiative, really, and we are proud of that because we are the first as a GCC country. Kuwait is leading the Professional Women Network among all the GCC countries, Aramco, Adjunct, Qatar, and even Bahrain and Oman. So why we created that committee is to enable fair condition at work for women and men, enrich career opportunity for women, uplift some of the facility because the facility in operation, gathering center and rig, we don't have for women, and really we did now change that. Raise the awareness about gender gaps present in our companies. So our objective, to make it short, is to advance women in the oil and gas sector in Kuwait. We aim to create women that see no barrier in reaching the highest role in the technical and managerial skill. Some of our achievement, really, we already uplift all the field facility to accommodate for women. Nearly we have 27 gathering center and more than 100 rig. We have all these, we upgrade, we put facility for women. We launched 5 pilot. In refinery, we don't have operator as female. So recently we launched 5 engineer women to be an operator in refinery. This is the first, nearly we have 75 years of history in refinery. This is the first time we are doing that. Raising awareness in so many events. We conduct so many workshops. We invite a lot of executive from international oil company like Exxon, Total, Shell, BP, and even service company, Schlumberger, Halliburton, Baker Hughes. And now we are analyzing our diversity and inclusion, and we put that as indicator in our balance scorecard. So there is focus of the leadership that we need to see this number and grow in that number. So now I'd like to share with you some of my experience, really, as a leader in our industry. When I joined a Kuwait Oil Company, I was a young engineer. I'm graduated as chemical engineer. I joined the company of upstream, which is oil and gas exploration, development, and production. So I studied 2 years, petroleum engineer, and I grew in this company as reservoir engineer. I'm a reservoir engineer. Then I was, there was a lot of challenge because the environment was only male-dominated environment. I worked very hard. I took all the challenge that given to me. So I climbed the ladder. I became a superintendent or team leader of one of the biggest assets in Kuwait, the Greater Burgan, which is producing today 1.7 million barrels per day. Then I moved to as a manager, the first manager in the history of Kuwait, Kuwait Oil Company. Then in 2007, I became a deputy managing director of an asset which is producing 500,000 barrels. Then 2007, I moved to a deputy managing director for another asset, which is North Kuwait asset, producing 750,000 barrels per day and a plan to produce 1 million. I was supervising more than 2,000 staff from the company and nearly managing $12 billion of project in that area with developing of heavy oil and water injection plan, gathering center. So it's a lot of a challenge. And at some time, I face a lot of difficulty because in the night they call you if there is fire or if there is any incident, I should be there. So I could manage and climb this career. Then I moved to COFPIC, the international arm of our industry, abroad. So I was managing 60 projects around the world in 15 countries. Recently, I moved to the downstream, which is new to me, as petrochemical industry in Kuwait, as deputy CEO. And this is another challenge, and I accept that challenge. So my message, really, for young women and in the industry, in the oil industry, look for the tough challenges. Do not accept the easy one. Ask for more open and honest feedback. Unless you have those feedback, you can't understand what you are doing. Ensure your family support you. Unless you have family support, I have my husband, my mother, they were a big supporter for me. When I were at work, I leave my children with my mother. Then when they grow up, my husband is a great supporter for me. So unless you have a family support, as a young engineers, you can't do your work perfectly. Most importantly, work very hard. There is no substitute for hardworking and full commitment, really, without expecting recognition. So, when we think about this leader, we imagine them very big, very tall, very unreachable. This is like this is a lighthouse. This is the biggest lighthouse in the Europe. It's in France. This light built to guide the ship safely to the coast. It looks high, huge, unreachable, so tall, but each light tower has an inner view. This is the inner view of that light. See how much stair we have here. That runs to the top, the stair. Each leader has to climb their inner step, step by step, each step to get to the top, mastering our own skill and also our own issue and challenges. To reach to the top, create your own light tower. Climb each step, reach to the top. Thank you very much.
So thank you, Hosnia. That was really great remarks. Thank you very much. So to remind for those of us who are watching online and listening as well, today we're here, we're going to start the panel discussion. My name is Mona Sutphin, which I realized I don't think I said when I first started, but that's fine. We're here, we're going to start the panel on diversity and inclusion in the energy sector. We've just heard from Hosnia Hashim, who's from the Kuwaiti Petrochemical Industries Company called PIC. We're also joined by Ellen Morris. Ellen teaches energy and enterprise development at Columbia here at SEPA, and she's a former director of the Energy and Environmental Concentration here. She has been an ambassador for the Clean Energy Education and Empowerment Initiative, and also a founding partner of a social enterprise called Embark Energy. She's also the president and founder of a consulting firm called Sustainable Energy Solutions. In 2007, Ellen was the co-founder of ARC Finance, which is an organization that promotes and expands access to end-user finance for the modern energy industry. And she's been a senior consultant for the UN Development Program on sustainable energy in the developing world. She's been working all around, if you care about development, this is really, we were just talking before the panel, focused on developing countries and their access and plans for energy in this day and age. And she's worked in Latin America and Haiti and India and Sub-Saharan Africa, so her background is very broad. And she started her career in clean energy work for the National Renewable Energy Lab and as a science advisor to the U.S. Congress and an exploration geophysicist at Texaco. So I am going to get in at some point into the question of technical background in this field, because I think it is a little bit of a gating issue for diversity and inclusion, at least from my perspective. So, and we're also joined by Dr. Phil Sharp, who's a fellow here at the Center for Global Energy Policy. He joined the center pretty recently, right? Just 6 months ago. Yeah, I was just going to say 2 months ago, maybe, after stepping down as president of Resources for the Future, which is a great nonprofit focused on sustainability and clean energy. He was in the U.S. House of Representatives from Indiana, so cares, I'm sure, deeply about U.S. politics. I know that's not the subject of this panel, but let's just say it's a heightened moment with 20 days until the election, so everybody who's here, hope you're voting. It's a little aside. After leaving Congress, he's been involved a lot in the public policy elements of the U.S. energy infrastructure, a member of the National Research Council Committee on the Effectiveness and Impact of Corporate on the CAFE Standard. He chaired the Secretary of Energy's Electric Systems Reliability Task Force. He's taught before at Ball State University and at Harvard's Kennedy School, and served as the director of the Harvard Institute of Politics, which is a great program. He was also a research fellow at Harvard in Environmental and Natural Resources, on the advisory board at MIT at their energy initiative. He was also a board director at Duke Energy and a congressional chair of the National Commission on Energy Policy when he was in the Congress. So we have a really great panel today to talk about the issues of diversity and inclusion in what I think everybody here, certainly in this room, would agree is one of the most important sectors in the global economy and certainly in the U.S. economy as well. So thank you to the panelists today for joining. I'm going to start a little bit with Dr. Sharp, just because I know he has to leave shortly to go teach. And so I wanted to start, Phil, with a question about the interest of and diversity in the clean energy sector versus the traditional oil and gas sector. I mean, my impression is always that the traditional oil and gas sector, as Hosnia pointed out, has been a very culturally male-dominated field for a lot of reasons. I do want to get into that question. But I'm just curious, from your perspective working in the clean energy space, and Ellen, you might want to comment on this as well, is it also true in the clean energy field, because it is a scientifically driven field, that the pipeline isn't deep enough? Or are we finding that women and lots of ethnic and cultural diversity, that people are more interested in that part of the sector than in the traditional oil and gas sector? I'm just curious. Well,
first, thank you so much for inviting me to be here. Frankly, as a former member of the U.S. Congress, I'm happy to be invited just about anywhere. I was delighted to hear Hosnia's speech. It was both inspiring and informative, both in what she personally has done and achieved, but in what appears to be the very significant activities to transform the sector in Kuwait. Those efforts are to be applauded. Let me, I'm not sure I have an answer to your question that's accurate. Ellen may know better because I don't study these figures. That's not my field of activity. But I will just say from observation, first you should recognize that in fact in the U.S. energy sector there has been a transformation if you go back 30 or 40 years. Sure, I can remember true. When we had the first person testifying before my congressional committee in either the late 70s or 1980s from an oil company who was a woman. That they were willing to put her on the stage to testify. And what we see now is in almost all of the major companies, you will find women. I don't think we have gender parity, so we don't go on your chart as you showed in Northern Europe. But also, that transformation has been very significant. I mean, first there's the breakthrough at the top, which she's talking about at the top of the lighthouse. And that's very important anywhere, breaking the glass ceiling. And by the way, if you'll pardon me, but this week in American political system, we saw two dramatic examples of this. One last night, where we almost certainly saw the next president of the United States, who will be the first woman president of the United States. And secondly, much less known and less observed, is in the US Supreme Court. They had what is either the only or a rare session in which, session in which there was actually gender parity among the participants in the case that was being argued before the Supreme Court. 5 male justices, 3 female justices, which of course is the most we've ever had. We only had 4 in history. But all the counsel arguing the case that was before them were women. So you had, I understand it, 5 and 5. This was observed in a major newspaper article. These are only representative of the kind of change that has occurred. When I was on the Duke Energy Board of Directors, we had occasion to have to pick a new CEO to run this. This is, by some measures, the largest electric utility in the U.S. system. We picked a woman, Lynn Good, who, by the way, is a good example for people to examine her career. Kind of thing. And Lynn was competing against, I don't know how many men that were in the original pool kind of thing. But the fact was that all the old white males on this board of directors agreed that she was by far the most significant choice. And she was unanimously selected by the board. The board tended to be favor, as do so many of these things, the pale male and stale crowd. But in fact, that is changing too. But the point I really want to make, excuse me, and I won't carry on that, is that these are the shattering of what we call the glass ceilings. What's really important, of course, is not just that, but it is, what do the rooms look like in this building, not just the ceilings? And do we have really significant numbers? And I would suggest to you that if you're a woman moving into one of these things, it is far more likely today that you will be competing in the recruitment against other women and not against males. And in fact, I've seen that in a variety of places where there might be one male and 4 females or one thing. We just at RFF, this resource organization, only 70 people, but a male had the position of a vice president for finance and administration, really the COO position, for 35 years, and he retired. And in the recruitment, we ended up with the final two finalists were women, very clearly. And this was a very, for most people, would be a very high-paying job, well over $200,000. And my point being that this shows you the frame of the breadth of this issue today. That doesn't mean all the hurdles are not there and one doesn't happen, but I would just reinforce what Hosnia said. Those characteristics that she talked about, being prepared, learning, adapting, working hard, they should serve you as male or female, but I can assure you most institutions are not well run. They need strong talent, and so there are lots of openings at lots of levels, but I'll quit there.
Thanks. Ellen, do you want to just comment on that for a second?
Sure. I come from a totally different perspective, which is in sub-Saharan Africa most recently, working with electric utilities in Malawi and with the economic community of West African states in West Africa. And what comes to mind is recent work in Malawi. The electric utility has 2,500 people, and they have something like 17 female engineers. So the numbers are daunting, really, there. And they are now in the process of trying to think about a more inclusive utility sector, and there is only one utility in Malawi, and trying to think of how to build the talent pool of engineers, female engineers. It's a super much bigger challenge, I would say, in Africa in terms of the education system and equal access to education, because generally it's favored for the men and the boys to have the higher education, and women are relegated to more administrative jobs and secretarial jobs. And so that they struggle with how do we, yes, we're interested in increasing the number of women technical people in the utility, but the talent pool is too small. So they're actually looking at how do we fundamentally change the education system from primary to secondary to tertiary school to basically make it an environment where women and girls are encouraged to study technical fields because, you know, it's such an ingrained culture in places like Malawi, and the opportunities for both men and women are very, very limited because of the extreme difficulties with day-to-day life, whether it's access to electricity or food security or any access to water and other things happening in both urban and rural areas. So I think the clean energy sector specifically might have a different kind of opportunity for women, because the clean energy sector in Africa tends to be smaller, more distributed utilities, household systems, which actually could open up opportunities for women entrepreneurs. And recognizing that not every woman wants to be an entrepreneur, so programs that say women entrepreneurship, you must do it. A lot of people, men and women, don't necessarily want to be that entrepreneur. However, with these smaller, more nimble companies that are created in sub-Saharan Africa, focused in places where there is no electricity grid, there are, I would say, more opportunities for women to both recognize what products make sense for their customers, and also, how to build out those distribution channels. However, the big challenge for women over men, and it's seen all over Africa, is access to finance, access to land. So those kinds of basic things, which men typically have relatively easy access to, are not widely available to women. So access to credit to start a business is not necessarily readily available. So with those kinds of constraints met, I think it actually could be an interesting alternative model to sort of centralized utilities and trying to move that large ship in a short amount of time.
Yeah, that's really interesting. So actually, let me come back to this thing that's in the back of my mind, which is for both of you, Ellen and Hosnia, you have a technical background in the field. I mean, you're trained as a scientist. And have worked in roles in the industry, learning the field from a technical perspective. I think probably some of the people in this audience and online may or may not want to become a, you know, a chemical engineer, may not have the inclination to do that. Is it a, are there pathways to success without that kind of technical degree? Or is there a kind of almost inherently, whether it's clean energy or traditional oil and gas, is there a limitation if you don't have a degree in science to undergird your path forward? I'm curious.
As industry, I don't think it's only engineers.
Okay.
All the
That's
companies.
That's good to hear for everybody who.
We need HR. We need economists. We need financial. We need environmental. So all the kinds of all the disciplines is needed for any oil company to grow. So it's not only engineers. So we accept all, but the number of engineers is much more because it's an oil and gas geologist, petrophysicist, petroleum engineer, chemical engineer, whatever kind of engineer. But it doesn't. But who will support those engineers? We need all the support from all the disciplines. So it's not only an engineering disciplines career. No, we accept all.
And can I just ask you a follow-up question? In your case, if you come in to into the sector and you show promise in some other, let's say you're in finance and you're working in the actual financial part of the company, can you, are there opportunities to learn the other, to really touch the operational side of the business, or are you kind of always going to stay then in the finance part of the business?
As career, I think we have career path for all the incomers to the company. If it's finance, he or she will go to that career path, and we are like the specialization. So we do the specialization for all the disciplines. So we don't have a finance go to engineering side unless he can. We should convert him to have some of years of experience as to the university.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that makes sense. So he's sending back to school. Ellen, I don't know if you want to comment.
Yeah, I'm just going to quickly add. In my experience, and again, Phil, I was thinking of you because, you know, my entry point into the U.S. Congress was as a science fellow working as a science advisor in the environment subcommittee that you know about. And to me, it feels like having a solid, maybe in my skill set is a technical skill, is also the sort of analytical skills that come with that kind of technical training, which allows you then to then branch out into things like public policy, because in the public policy realm, they're always looking for that sound technical evaluation of whatever it is, whether it's clean water, whether it's clean energy, whatever it happens to be. And so I find, and what I advise young women in education is to, you know, think about, you know, getting that sort of harder skill set, that sort of technical skill set, which is a great launching platform for a lot of different things. So not to say that if you don't do that, you can't do these other things, but I would say, you know, my advice to younger women is to think about your using those analytical skills as a foundation to do many things, and that might be engineering, or it might be medicine, or it might be, you know, any
water,
number of things. Yeah. So, but I think it's interesting because in the U.S. Congress, there's a lot of people thinking about policy with no real grounding in what's behind those policies. And I don't know if you want to.
I was just going to say to felt like. You hear this technical, really strong underpinning of knowledge, and you know from Washington, which is how I ended up getting involved in energy policy, was because it just crossed my desk and somebody said, okay, this is a really important issue. Okay, we then have to learn it kind of from scratch, so I would be calling your equivalents inside the administration to understand what exactly is going on. But I'm curious about this disconnect, because I'm sure lots of people here in the room and certainly in the audience online and who are going to download this in the future are interested in the public policy career element. And is that a pathway that you can kind of jump into? Or is it kind of career limiting at some point if you don't have this technical background in the field?
Well, first of all, I think my impression is that there are so many different pathways that you want to be careful about thinking you're locked in.
That's true.
At the same time, I think you're very wise to develop a substantive background in something, whether it's in medical policy or being a scientist or a doctor or a skill set. But then it's starting with the idea that life is all about learning. And you're going to be learning if you want to expand wherever you are. Because one of the most significant problems I suspect here at Columbia University, we saw it at Harvard, I see it, is, and in most institutions, is what we call stovepiping. And that is that once you're in, you were just talking about, well, if you're in finance, it's hard to get over into operations or whatnot. This is a universal in almost all institutions, and almost everybody that manages them or advises them said, you've got to work to overcome it. And nobody in my that I've been exposed to has ever figured out exactly how to do that. And the other part of that, too, that I would just advise in this adaptability, get a core, as Ellen is saying, but trying to be adaptable in a learning mode. So the key going back to is getting the learning skills is central, and that's part of what this university is all about, so that you can apply them. Again, anybody who thinks that it's over on learning when you in this is going to miss out. I do want to say one, but the other thing is over time, these paths change, and it's very hard to know that 25 years from now, if I start out on this path, I can get there or over here. That is a wonderful thing in terms of having opportunity and adaptability, but it also can be quite anxiety creating. If you take a look at the electric utility system and the top management in that over the last 40, 50 years, it was almost universally engineers for many, many decades. Then suddenly it became lawyers and finance people. The woman I just mentioned, Lynn Good, whom I'm an enormous admirer of, by the way, she has two sons that are probably in college age, so she hasn't had to sacrifice. She had a lot of sacrifices, but the point being, she didn't have to say, well, I can't have a family and get to where I'm going to get, kind of proposition. But Lynn comes out of being a CPA. She was auditor to one of the utilities that ultimately became part of them, and she worked her way up. Now, the CEO of that, her previous CEO, Jim Rogers, did a very interesting thing that his board of directors was not sure was smart. And at one point, he took everybody, the six or so people who had major functional responsibilities in the corporation, and he swapped them around. And he said, because that way I'm going to find out what their weaknesses are and their talents are, and we want to merge with another company, and they did ultimately with Duke, and I got to find out whether we have a team that's capable of doing that or not. One or two of those people, they discovered belonged only in one stovepipe, and they didn't advance in the corporation. The ones that mowed across. I don't mean to raise this, but I'm just trying to get you into the mode of try to get a strong core, but recognize that adaptability is one of the key characteristics. Mm-hmm. So and I know in politics, adaptability is everything.
Right, yeah. Like riding the wave, the tsunami wave. You're just trying not to drown and keep moving forward. I know we're going to lose you in 5 minutes. Can I ask you one last question before we lose you, which is the importance of networking at the in a sector, finding people who have passion for your interest. I always, at least in Washington, I think it's actually quite easy because there's so many different opportunities because there are roundtables and events that where you can be with other people who are at your same career path. I think it's a little harder in New York, to be honest. It strikes me. But I'm just curious about how, where you put that in the range of things that are a priority when
you're... Well, two things. It's important, but by the way, I personally never thought of myself as a good networker until I finally retired. and so I don't see it as essential. It's wise to try to do and to find people. When I was head of the Director Institute of Politics, we used to have seminars like this about women in politics and how to break in and how to advance, and we would get those that had already previously been elected. And universally, they said, for a woman particularly, but it's true for men too, is finding not just a role model that's at a distance, but somebody that will help mentor you. And very often, people who are the first to break in these institutions are more than willing to try to share and help people come along, especially as they get older, whether in the middle of it, they don't have time to do anything. But the point is that mentorship and goes to networking, but it's a more narrow kind of networking, but also among your colleagues, just finding one or two people that you feel comfortable talking with. When I made the vice president of our research organization, we picked a woman that had been in the organization quite some time. I was pleasantly surprised that she took on the task of learning about leadership. She said, this is my research now. I have to learn about leadership. And she put together three or four women that she had known at various places in the university and otherwise as people she could just call and say, you know, I don't know how to deal with this. What do I do about this or that? But it is that is an element of networking that is really valuable. And you can start now, but it'll develop over time.
I just wanted to add, you know, in the whole idea of mentoring, it's always assumed that the woman would be the mentor for another woman. Oh, and I think you need to think broadly, because there's so relatively few women working in the space, in the energy sector, that we need to sort of broaden our thinking of what mentorship is and who can do that mentoring, because there's plenty of awesome men, enlightened men, who can be that mentor.
Also, there's a lot of men that need a woman as a mentor because they don't know how to behave when they get a boss that is a woman.
And good point.
There's a lot of change that's underway. I apologize. I have to leave to teach my class.
So we're still here with the roundtable on the panel on diversity and inclusion, and we're just going to continue the conversation, and then we're going to open it up for questions in a little bit, I think, from the panel, from the audience here. But let me pick up on this mentoring issue, because I found it, I take your point, Ellen, that some of my best mentors have been men. If you need different mentors at different times of your career. I think people have a tendency to think that you're going to stick with your mentor through your whole career. And what I see young people who are trying to break into whatever sector it is, politics, energy, banking, finance, people have a tendency to think that the most senior, high-profile person they know should be their mentor, when in fact, most of the decisions that you make are going to be much closer to somebody who's maybe 10 years into the field rather than 20 or 30 years into the field. Because to Phil's point, and as we all know from this industry, from this whole sector, it's changing so rapidly. The advice you're going to get from somebody who's just a little further ahead from you in your career on, well, how do I navigate what the best opportunities are? How do I figure out who's hiring? What's going on in the sector? What kind of environments are really trying to work to promote inclusion and diversity in the workplace, those are going to be from peers. They're not necessarily going to be from somebody who's sitting pretty far away from the day-to-day. So I don't know how you are dealing with the networking and mentoring. I'm assuming that's a component of what you have to focus on in Kuwait, so people don't feel like they're alone as they move through the system. Just curious how you...
Yeah, we are in Kuwait, especially in Kuwait, our company, we have that. The network is really to exchange the knowledge of the international company, because some company, they start doing that professional women network before us. So that communication, and we are learning from their mistake, that's, I think, it give us a head up that how to move in easy way. So that's the network. The mentoring, we have, when our young professional join, if they are engineer or even finance, admin, we have for each one a mentor. It's a program that mandated by the company to have a mentor for each men and women. It's not female and male. It's not only for female. And it depend on the group of people available at the business. So sometime all my career my mentor was men. It's because the female is
just
very few.
You were the first woman. Yeah. So either you couldn't have, there wouldn't be a woman mentor for you.
So we learn, unless you have support from your management, the men, your colleague, I don't think that you can excel. It shouldn't be a female should be the mentor. That's the situation in Kuwait.
Yeah, very interesting. Ellen, I don't know if you have thoughts on that.
I think I mean, I spend a lot of time with students talking about career paths and a lot of time with women students because, you know, I'm one of those people, like Hosnia, who was one of the first people working in oil and gas and went to a male-dominated engineering school, et cetera. So I spend a lot of time discussing what Phil sort of said is like there's no set path and there's no, you know, you're always learning and you're always shifting. And I'm sure you could say the same about your own career path. But one thing that I found really useful that was launched relatively recently is something called the Clean Energy Education and Empowerment Initiative that was launched out of the Clean Energy Ministerial. And really that is a group that was launched to really recognize this gender gap working in specifically the clean energy space. And so it's a group that includes young women, mid-career women, and veteran women who have been in the space for a long time. And they create opportunities for networking and peer learning and mentoring. And it's, you know, for any of the young people out there interested in clean energy, this is a tremendous resource for at women at all levels working in the clean energy space. So I and myself are an ambassador to that, and so it's really focused on being that role model for women who are interested in furthering their career. And it's really started in the U.S., but now it's going internationally. So there are hubs of what's called C3E, Clean Energy Education and Empowerment, and those C3E hubs in international context, and I always think about Africa, because there are really even far fewer people, women, professionals working in the energy sector. And so to have those folks specifically in an African setting be able to access what's going on with C3E that was started in the U.S., I think is an awesome opportunity. So I'm just, for me, that kind of a network is hugely valuable. And that network includes men and women as well. So it's really geared towards looking at the gender gap. But I think we all recognize until men and women look at that gender gap, we won't make any headway. So we can't do this alone, women. It's a partnership with men.
Yeah. And who hosts, like, what's the...
So it's launched out of the Clean Energy Ministerial, which is, I don't know how many countries working on... So it's started by U.S. Department of Energy and Massachusetts Institute of Technology. And National Renewable Energy Laboratory is also involved in it. So there's a few different sort of institutional leads for it. But I would say it's really U.S. Department of Energy and MIT to start with. And now some other folks are coming in.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah. That's great. That's actually very interesting.
Yeah, hopefully I want you to know more about it.
Yeah, exactly. Hopefully it'll create a pipeline of
talent,
which is something I'd like to talk about, which is... How, and then we'll open up for questions after that, which is how do you figure out how to recruit people if you are limited in how many engineers are coming out of the university system, let's say? Is there are you finding it difficult to really attract women and find pools of women who would be naturally interested in the field, or is it getting easier because now there are more women like you in the space and so more role models and all that?
Yeah, we are facing difficulty now to find men to recruit, not female, yeah,
so
to recruit.
People to recruit.
Yes. No, eventually a number of female now graduating as engineer from Kuwait University is nearly more than 60%. So the pool of young professional female is much more than needed for our industry, really. So we have a transparent process for recruitment in Kuwait that when they finish, it's GPA, interview, there is exam for English exam and subject exam. So who got the most higher grade will enter. So, and the most higher grade today is female because they are top in the university and even in the high school, they are top. Before it was, when you join university as high school, the grade for men is less than female. Maybe 60%, 70, he can enter engineering. And for female, it's 85. Now the government delete that. Because a lot of men today, they don't, not all, they go to the university. There's a lot of opportunity for men in Kuwait more than female. That's why, for example, military, police, so many diploma. So that's why we have nearly 60-70% graduation today is female from very high marks in the university. So we don't have any difficulty today to recruit female in Kuwait. We are facing difficulty in recruiting male. Yes.
So you may be the first industry sector to really close the gender gap in a serious way. I mean, 10 years from now, that will be, you'll be 50-50.
Yes, that's sure, why right? we I mean, want to change the culture of the operation guys to accept female in the industry of refining operation. For example, as engineering, field development, geologist, geophysicist, we have a lot of female, more than men. But how to bridge the gap of operation? Female, that's the thing that we are now tackling. Putting five or nearly more, we have a program to put the engineers in refinery working as operator. To change the culture of the men that they should accept female in those hard environment. And same thing for drilling rig. We are putting female in the drilling rigs to change the culture of that it's not only male-dominated activities. It's harsh environment, but they accept that. So we need to support them.
Yeah, no, that's really, I mean, I have to say how innovative that is, just having spent time in the U.S. industry, this question of the operational level part of the industry is incredibly male-dominated in a way that I think is still very consistent. I mean, I have yet to see anybody at a rig working who's a woman in any capacity. Obviously, field teams are deployed. This is in the traditional oil and gas sector, deployed pretty remotely. And I literally have been at many sites. I've actually never seen a woman on site in any of them. So it's and that's in the U.S. So it's so when you solve this, you're gonna come back and tell everybody, all the other companies in the world, on how to do this and make it be a good experience for everybody. Right. So it will work. Yeah. So.
Tara, since you mentioned the drilling rigs, so early in my career, part of the job was to be an on-site geophysicist looking at the operations as the drilling was going. And I remember going out to an offshore rig in offshore California, and I arrived by helicopter, and this guy who was on the rig just said, "What are you doing out here? We don't have any women out here." And I said, "Well, my company, you know, I'm the on-site geophysicist, and I'm going to be here for a whole week." And they were like, "We don't have any women out here, and you are in the totally wrong place." I mean, that was a whole different many years ago, but hearing what you're saying.
I don't think it's changed very much. Yeah, no, I think it's very.
And I just want to say one more thing about there's a difference between attracting women to the space and retaining women in the space. And we see there's a lot of work to be done around, yeah, there may be great incoming numbers, but there still needs to be things changing in the workplace to retain women in the workplace and to see them rise up to these levels where you all are, because there's a lot of attrition, things related around workplace issues, work policies, family leave, whatever it happens to be. And so we see that also as a huge challenge in the energy sector, which tends to be still male-dominated. Those rules are written by men, and or men don't necessarily have the same desires, and so just flagging that.
Yeah, it is a challenge.
Yeah, it's difficult that because our legislation prevents women working in shift, but we do put them as day workers, as operator. What we are doing now, I wrote a letter to the minister. Our minister of oil wrote a letter to. We draft that letter We have two laws prevent women to work in harsh environment and shift workers. So we wrote a letter to the Minister of Workers Affairs, and she's a lady, to exclude that two laws for the oil sector. Mm. And that letter went 1 month back to her, and we're going to meet with her, and I wish that those two laws will be changed for the oil sector female workers. And our initiative is to change that law. So we are in the path to change those laws.
Yeah, that's great. Yeah, because it is a big issue, the gating issue for people coming in, and the workforce, I mean, the work-life balance is a big issue, obviously, in a variety of sectors. This one in particular, because you're right, a lot of the policies are not written with this in mind, that women might come in and out of the workforce. There needs to be flexibility in terms of schedule, a whole bunch of issues, which is obviously a much bigger conversation than this panel, because it goes to the global kind of workforce management issues. So I think we'll close out the formal part of this discussion, and I really want to open it up to everybody here. So for those people who are watching this online and ultimately are going to listen to it, we're with a panel today on diversity and inclusion in the energy sector. We're at the Columbia Center for Global Energy Policy, and I'm joined here by Ellen Morris and Hosnia Hashim. And I'm Mona Sutphin, the moderator. So can we, I'm just curious, people in the room, if you have any questions. Yes, if you can just let us know who you are. And
first of all, hello, good morning, Ms. Hashim and Ms. Morris. Thank you for sharing your insights with us, and specifically for Ms. Hashim, thank you for coming to SIPA. My name is Kanya Muksin, and I'm a graduate student studying international affairs in the energy and environment concentration. I have a question from Ms. Hashim. So post the COP21, the global community is striving to maintain the world temperature rise below 2 degrees Celsius. And yet traditional or conservative activities in the oil industry in general seems contradicting to that effort. So how will Kuwait's oil and gas industry play a role in preventing the negative effects of climate change and possibly be a leader in developing sustainable and clean energy? And what are the roles of women in the oil and gas industry for that initiative? Thank you.
Excellent question. Thank you very much. As Kuwait, nearly 95% of our income is from oil. So today we are producing 3 million barrels per day. And the policy of the company is, first, there is no flaring. So we did, we as a government, they put huge capital investment to reduce the gas flaring to the earth. So today, it was maybe 10 years back, nearly 40% or 30%, where we were flaring gas. Today, we are less than 1%, which is a huge reduction of gas flaring to the environment. And that will be sustained, and it's not acceptable as environment to flare any gas. It become one of the policy of the company, that there is a strategic percentage that allow the companies to flare gas. Second thing, as refineries, now we are putting nearly more than $12 billion in a project to produce clean fuel gas. So even for electricity, for cars, it's now become a very high standard of fuel. So the emission of the gasoline, it's less because it's to the highest standard. So there's a lot of it's a fact and program and project that prevent the companies to produce or to do something bad for the environment. Same thing for it's only not the gas, even the land. There is not allowed to dispose any water in the land. As industry, we always dispose water from the production, from the rig, cuttings. All these are now, it's not prevented. Because technology is helping us that we can dispose those underground. as land, as space, we are now as Kuwait leading in those initiatives. Women is part, your second question, women is part of the integral activities within the company. So their role is we are helping our strategy. We are part of those programs. So we don't differentiate between women and men because it's part of our job. So we are part of the integral organization helping on all these activities.
Thank you.
My name is Claire Bruff. I work for ASME, and I am the Manager of Volunteer Leadership Development there. Excuse me. And I also support our Diversity and Inclusion Strategy Committee, so I work on our Diversity and Inclusion Strategy in the organization. You mentioned that diversity and inclusion is an indicator in your balanced scorecard, and I think that's so necessary for any organization or corporation to really succeed. It has to be a focus of leadership in the organization. I'm wondering if you can elaborate on what were the motivations, how that got there, how the company changed and recognized that this was a priority and essential to the future of the organization.
That has been recently done through that committee, which is the Professional Women Committee, which we have formed in 2009. We saw the other companies like Shell, Exxon, Chevron, and those companies, Total, they shared with us that this is part of their balanced scorecard. So we tried and we approached. We have an excellent support from the corporation CEO. So when we told him that we need those numbers to be inserted and we need to understand those numbers, he was open for that, and it has been part of our balanced scorecard. So support from the leadership, plus it came from us as a female through that committee.
And I just wanted to add something. What I've seen on the international sort of developing country side is
there's obviously a lot of donor funds coming in to help influence change related to increasing access to energy and increasing access to clean energy. And now, you know, many donors, most donors, multilateral and bilateral donors, require these kinds of not necessarily a scorecard, but definitely metrics around gender, gender equality, workforce issues, procurement issues. And so they're sort of influencing from their placement of the funding to include those kind of conditions around the deployment of their funds, whether it's going to a utility, whether it's going to a regional development organization, whatever it might be. So I think that's an important driver. And then, you know, helping those countries then implement those kinds of metrics.
Thanks for following that. My name is Alexis Stubb. I'm with the Clinton Climate Initiative, and we work in renewable energy in island countries, our team, and then we also manage Women in Renewable Energy Network, which is our network, including women into the renewable energy sector and providing means of networking and growth opportunities and mentoring. Shameless plug, apologies. I do want to follow up on the conditional lending question or point that you made. I found that very interesting, and I was just curious if you have seen that grow over recent years and when you've seen that aspect come into the conditions for grants, etc. Is that a newer phenomenon?
I would say it's a relatively new timeline. Many of the organizations and institutions and donors and investors I work with are really focused on energy access as a driver for economic growth, while recognizing that you can't leave half of the population out, and that without specific requirements around creating a more gender and inclusive, gender equitable and inclusive environment, that you know, this whole idea of increasing energy access as a driver for economic development will fall short. So I would say it's probably come to pass in the last 5 years as being something very much tied to the recipient in terms of the in the conditions of accepting those funds, they are required to do that. And this is a lot from the U.S. government, but also other bilateral donors who see this as something which is important to happen. And the recipient countries also recognize that it's an important thing to happen. So it's not, you know, you must do this and, you know, whether you want to or not, because what I find is most countries recognize this as a huge gap in a lot of their the rollout of their rural electrification strategies, the rollout of their enterprise development funds, the rollout of climate, whatever it happens to be. However, you know, having that capacity and having that the skills necessary to sort of do some of this work is where it falls short. So I think being mindful of it's not going to happen overnight, but I think it's a huge step when, you know, electric utilities in Malawi are developing a gender policy. I mean, to me, that's far and above, you know, some of the companies that Phil Sharp has worked with in the U.S. So they're sort of leapfrogging over some of the sort of backward policies that we have in the U.S. For some of the industries to, you know, a gender policy in electric utility is a pretty amazing thing. And it's helping them get to the implementation of that, which is going to be the challenge.
Questions?
We can keep going.
Okay, well, I expand on this,
sure.
Actually? I guess the examples you gave and the example you have, of course, are both abroad, but these are challenges we do have here in the States. And I'm wondering, you know, is any of this replicable to American companies and organizations? You know, government contracts, where are these things, could these things be built in to ensure greater diversity and inclusion here?
And what you see, I'll just comment on this a little bit because I'm on the board of an energy company, that what I've been really interested in is that just because of the way that our public financial markets work, there's so much more focus on making sure that certainly publicly listed companies are diverse. It's something that people are measuring. It's something that companies are getting rewarded for by, you know, Fortune magazine or whatever it is, there's now metrics on how well you're doing. And in the U.S. energy, at least the traditional energy sector for sure, there's a big demographic cliff that's happening, right, as people retire. And so to some of the points that both panelists have made, the retention of women in the senior ranks and managerial ranks of companies is becoming a really pressing concern. So I like to think that it's because people feel like they should have a diverse workforce, but it's actually really, a lot of it is also, these are really talented women who are moving through the system. We can't afford to lose that talent at the mid-career point. And both investors and the public are interested in demanding more. So I've been, you know, happily surprised at how many what you would think is traditionally not particularly interested in diversity CEOs and senior executives, how proud they are to be able to say, oh, we've increased our, you know, retention of senior women by 25%, or we received this award, et cetera, et cetera. So I think just because of our market mechanisms, I think it works slightly differently in the U.S., but the investor pressure is really where you see it the most, because you have to report on a lot of this these days. So. And, you know, there's nothing like a competition in the U.S., right? So in any industry, if you say, like, oh, so-and-so's doing this so much better, yeah, it sets off, like, a race to get to the top. Everybody wants to be in that top 10%, whatever that top 10% is. And so all you have to do is create some competition, and you'll naturally get people's juices flowing, at least in the U.S. So.
And I think you're a good example of being on a board,
mm-hmm.
being an amazing woman,
yeah.
working in the sector.
And we are, I'm on the board of Pioneer Natural Resources. We have, I think, the highest percentage of women on an energy company board, because there are 3 of us out of 13, which isn't saying much, but for this industry is quite significant. And we have 2 women who are incredibly talented. One ran the chemical business down and for Shell. The other one is a longtime CFO in the sector. And when you get to the point that you guys are thinking about boards, I've learned a ton from them about being a woman on a publicly traded company board. And
just the you see how difficult that is. That's a place where you know, investors again are demanding more diverse boards. In Europe, they dealt with it by requiring diversity on corporate boards. It's much broader than this industry, but the U.S. still has a major gap. Particularly, it's okay in consumer brands. It's okay in brands that are media related, but in almost all the industrial sectors, it's a really huge lag compared to Europe, let's say. And so we definitely have a lot of work to do in that part of the space.
For you, you said that companies are
proud to say that they have increased the diversity in their workforce, and you know the research shows that you know you have increased profits, more workplace satisfaction, all these other things that are clearly important to a private sector company. Do you see that also as one of the drivers?
Yes, and part of it is that. It's just the nature of the change in the world. I have a whole theory that this is really all being driven by Silicon Valley because the appeal for people to the idea that you would work on a campus, that you can wear jeans, that you can work creatively, that you might not have to be shackled to your desk for 10 hours a day, not to mention the free food and the massages and all that. But, you know, that aside, but the sense of productivity as an employment, as a culture, I think has really infused almost every sector in the United States. I see it in finance. I see it in every single sector we kind of look at. And what the standard has become for what an appealing workplace is something that's more flexible, more family-friendly, not just for women but for men as well, and more flexible for how people want to lead their lives because what they realize, what people have researched this, they've seen, workers, employees are much more productive if they feel like their company will give them the platform to be able to live their lives, to contribute back to community. So companies that have philanthropic arms that are doing community support, companies aren't creating these just out of whole cloth because they all of a sudden feel, oh yeah, this is a great thing to do. They're doing it because their employees are saying, I will not work for a firm that does not have some kind of way for me to express my interest in my community. And so the people are constructing these things. So I think it's really is a reflection of the change in the workforce environment, it just period, in the U.S. And hopefully will extend to the rest of the world over time. So other questions? Okay, I think, let me see how much, oh yeah, we're actually close. This is perfect timing, I can't believe it. That never happened. So we're gonna close here. First, I really wanna thank our two panelists and Hosnia Hashim, because she's fantastic and has come obviously from Kuwait, to tell us about really impressive innovation in this space. And so hopefully we'll have this panel, you know, 5 years from now, and she's gonna tell us how to make sure that the operation side of the oil and gas industry can diversify successfully. So thank you for coming and sharing your thoughts with us today. And for Ellen Morris, who shared with us her views and really interesting work going on in the developing world. So I'm going to close by thanking, and of course, Phil, who had to leave early. So as I mentioned at the outset, I'm just going to read through all this, that the full video and recording of this event will be available on the website in a few days, and you're going to be able to subscribe to the iTunes podcast on iTunes. It's also on Stitcher and SoundCloud and lots of other platforms. So you just have to look for CGEP to download that. And then I'm going to do a shameless plug for other events at the center that are upcoming. So first, we have a China's role in the global energy finance sector with Bo Kong and Kevin Gallagher. That's on Monday, October 24th, so just in a few days. 12 p.m. to 1:30 p.m. in Lerner Hall on the fifth floor, 555. A second panel is Disruptive Energy Futures with a physicist. That's really interesting. Amory Lovins, which is on Wednesday, November 2nd, from 7 to 9 p.m. at Columbia Law School in room 103. Then we have an IEA panel on the Renewable Energy Market Report, which I'm sure will be very interesting and people want to hear about that. That's going to be on Tuesday, November 1st, from 9:30 to 11 a.m. here at SEPA, I think in this room, 1501. And so I hope you all will support those events and definitely download them and listen to them online as well. So thank you, everyone, for attending today. We hope to see you soon at another event. Thank you.